Professor Shank Mohan Roy from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Mumbai. Professor Roy obtained his BSc degree in physics in 1960 and Master of Science in physics in 1962 from Delhi University, and subsequently obtained his PhD degree in 1966 from Princeton University. He is Raja Ramanna Fellow at prestigious Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education of Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. He has held numerous positions at Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, including Chairman, Theoretical Physics Group Committee from 1992 to 1997. He has been working in the areas of quantum foundations, quantum information processing, and elementary particle physics. Dr. Roy held visiting positions at University of California, San Diego, CERN Geneva, SUNY, Stony Brook, Syracuse, University of Alberta, Waseda University, among others. Professor S.M. Roy was awarded the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in Physical Sciences in 1981 and S.N. Bose Birth Centenary Gold Medal by Indian Science Congress in 2003. He started the Theoretical Physics Seminar Circuit, which has been running successfully for nearly 25 years with funding from Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. He has organized and lectured at many national conferences, schools, and workshops. I request Professor Shashank Mohan Roy to kindly deliver his talk.
I have here a rather long title, and the reason is that it covers the three subjects that I will touch upon, and each of these three subjects is less well known than it needs to be. One is causal quantum mechanics, the second, joint measurements of non-commuting observables. Third, entangled coherent states with large uncertainty product. And these three get correlated in a very natural way, as we shall discuss in a few minutes. First of all, quantum mechanics and the uncertainty principle was born in approximately 1922 with the work of Heisenberg. And of course, there were very many developments, including the work of Schrödinger immediately afterwards. And very strong questioning of the fundamentals of quantum mechanics by various practitioners. I will highlight just this photograph, which is a photograph of the people at the 1927 Solvay conference. And in particular, you will see here Niels Bohr and Einstein and various other luminaries, including Heisenberg, Schrödinger, Pauli, etc. But more particularly, the discussions today will focus on the initiation of the arguments by, you know who this is, and perhaps this photo is less well known than the preceding one. This is Louis de Broglie. This is David Bohm. This is John Bell. This is Eugene Wigner. And this, again, Another less well-known photograph than the others is that of John von Neumann, who has played a very, very important role in setting the foundations of quantum mechanics in as accurate a way as was possible. Well, the reason for all these discussions beginning with 1927 is that even though highly successful, there are many features of quantum mechanics which are hard to comprehend and extremely unfamiliar for people who have grown up with classical physics. The most important, perhaps, is that quantum mechanics has no causality. And according to Einstein, this is the most basic thing he would have liked to target. According to John Bell, whose work we will, many of you are familiar with, John Bell's main objection was not the lack of causality, but what he emphasized as the intrinsically approximate nature of quantum theory. That is, even in principle, you could not set up the principles of quantum mechanics in a way that is exact. Then there are other things, which is that the quantum state of the world is not like the classical description of this of the world. Like here I stand here, I see chairs and people seated there. If I wanted to describe this quantum mechanically, it's not like this at all. Because in quantum mechanics, the state of one particle or of many particles, even when completely known, will not tell you that one particle is situated somewhere, another somewhere else, etc. And a related fact is that unlike classical physics, there are no trajectories in quantum mechanics. You cannot follow through a particle like that. And more technically, quantum mechanics is context dependent and suffers from the paradoxes which were unearthed by Gleason, Kochensperger, and John Bell. So I start at the beginning to say what causality could mean. If you have here two polarizers and the photon passes through, and if the two polarizers have directions A1 and A2 which are not parallel, then the photon which has passed through the first polarizer has a probability cosine square theta of passing through the second polarizer. Now, the state of the photon which has passed through the first polarizer is completely known. Namely, it has to be parallel to the axis of the first polarizer. And yet, you are unable to say whether it will pass, it will reach the detector or not, because the probability of passage through the detector is cosine square theta. Now, this has the peculiar consequence. Of course, we get used to things. Maybe we have accepted that this is not so peculiar after all. It has the peculiar consequence that photons, if you exactly the same state, may result in photons which pass through or not. So different results have different causes. If you think that's causality, then photons which pass through have different properties from those which don't. And that is not reflected in the state vector or the wave function. And this led Einstein to say, I am rather firmly convinced that the essentially statistical character of contemporary quantum theory is solely to be ascribed to the fact that this theory operates with an incomplete description of physical systems. To hammer this point in a little bit against classical physics. In classical physics, if you have a state in which the particles have coordinates xi and momenta pi at t equals 0, then Newton's equations, the relativistic versions, would lead to new positions xi prime, pi prime at some later time t. Now it's possible, of course, for two particles which started off at two different points to end up at the same point at a later time. What is not possible is for two particles which have ended up at different points to have started at the same phase space point. Because if they start at some phase space point, their trajectory is determined. And so you cannot start here, go there, and start somewhere. That is, if you ended up somewhere else, you could not have started at the same point. So there is causality in classical physics in the sense that different results arise from different causes. And there is objective reality in the sense that position and momentum are properties independent of observation. And there is locality in the sense that xi, pi are independent of, that is not influenced by, actions at space-like separation. So before I come to John Bell, let me just say that in 1935, Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen went on to develop on this idea of Einstein of incompleteness of quantum mechanics and proved something which looked like a theorem that quantum mechanics is incomplete. But of course, all theorems are based on assumptions, and they had made an assumption which now is called Einstein locality, and which quantum mechanics, as has been shown by John Bell, is not respected. In quantum theory, the Einstein locality principle is not respected. Now, John Bell made his contribution in 1964, but I reproduce some copy of a transparency of John Bell's TIFR lecture in 1980. This lecture was entitled, "What in the World is Quantum Mechanics About Exactly?" Now, this, although it sounds rhetorical, actually each word here is there for a particular reason. So his argument was, quantum mechanics is about wave functions, Hamiltonian, Schrodinger equation, how to solve it. But what in the world? Because he said the wave function is not like the world, because the wave function is a superposition of something here and something there, and that is unrecognizable in our, at least classical, view of the world. So what we need to make sense out of this wave function in our laboratory is to say that when we make measurements, we see one particular value, although the wave function does not specify that value. So, and then what? Then how do we make contact with the predictions of quantum mechanics? We say that the statistical interpretation of measurement results makes us connect to the quantum wave function. Now here is the problem. Measurement presupposes a subject-object split of the world. That is, I have an object which is described by wave function, and I have a subject or a measurer which is described by classical coordinates, and the boundary is not sharply defined. You may, of course, according to practical necessities, sometimes enlarge the boundaries of the quantum system to take into account more and more quantum features that may be necessary. But even when you do that, since the boundary is not sharply defined, the theory is not sharply defined. So how does quantum mechanics work? It assigns probabilities of an observable A being observed to have the value little a, where little a is an eigenvalue of the operator capital A corresponding to that observable. Now the thing which may sound a little bit odd to emphasize is that these probabilities are not probabilities of the observable being A, but probabilities of A being observed to be A. Why is that distinction so important? So why is this distinction of being observed to be, I just want not to cover you, being observed to be A is different from probabilities of A being A? A simple illustration will focus attention on the difference. For instance, quantum mechanics will give you the probabilities of position being some value or of the momentum being observed to have some value. If they had existence, if these probabilities had existence independent of what is observed, then of course you will have a joint probability for Q and P. But such a joint probability is not specified in quantum mechanics, given the state vector. So this distinction of quantum mechanics assigning probabilities of observation rather than probabilities of being is something that is not to be ignored. And so Bell goes on to say quantum mechanics is intrinsically approximate, intrinsically ambiguous, because the subject-object boundary cannot be. So I have more or less said what he says in this slide. He says nobody knows what quantum mechanics says exactly about any situation, for nobody knows where the boundary really is between the wavy quantum system and the world of particular events. And this is the problem of quantum mechanics, according to John Bell. One could make some progress with this problem of quantum mechanics if we had a theory without observers, a theory without boundaries. And such theories have been attempted. And one of them is called the many universe interpretation, and there are others. But I shall focus today on what is actually one of the earliest theories, which is the theory of de Broglie and Bohm, which is called causal quantum mechanics. So I started by saying that quantum mechanics, as we have it, is not a causal theory. So what is causal quantum mechanics? In the de Broglie-Bohm theory, there is no boundary between, it is one universe. So de Broglie-Bohm picture disposes of the necessity to divide the world somehow into the system and apparatus. Now, how is this thing possible consistently with quantum mechanics? The idea of de Broglie and Bohm is that I see a particle hits the screen somewhere at some particular position, although the wave function does not predict that. The wave function gives only a probability distribution. So what is the idea? The idea is when we repeatedly prepare the system, when we do the measurement repeatedly, we are repeatedly preparing the system in the same initial state, and yet, of course, sometimes it hits here, sometimes it hits there. So the idea of de Broglie and Bohm is that we have an ensemble of initial points, initial positions. And corresponding to each initial position, we have a trajectory which leads from the initial to the final position. Now, to agree with quantum mechanics, what we need to do is that initially, the distribution of points in position space must agree with the position probability density. But we must also ensure that at all times this agreement remains. That is, the probability density for position must at all times agree with what is predicted by quantum mechanics. And this is what is achieved by the de Broglie-Bohm theory. So I have here an ensemble of points which have trajectories x of t, which are managed by de Broglie and Bohm to be such that the probability distribution at initial time goes over to the probability distribution at some later time in exact agreement with what is predicted by quantum theory. The de Broglie-Bohm theory, however, makes a distinction between position and momentum. If you looked at the momentum probability distribution, it does not agree with what is predicted by quantum mechanics. So position has a preferred status in the de Broglie-Bohm causal quantum mechanics. Now, we did not like that, and in 1995, we proposed what is called position momentum symmetric causal quantum mechanics. Now, one could naturally think that we will run into problems, because whereas in the de Broglie-Bohm description, the state, the complete specification of the state is by giving the wave function as well as the instantaneous position of the particular point. Here, we talk of specifying the state of the system by specifying the wave function or the state vector plus the position as well as momentum, simultaneously the position as well as the momentum of the particle. But we know that in quantum mechanics, position and momentum correspond to non-commuting observables. So what is the best we can expect or require of such a theory? The expectation that something fruitful will come out of it arises from the fact which was already pointed out by John von Neumann in his earliest formulations of quantum theory. He stressed that whereas exact measurements of two non-commuting observables simultaneously are not possible, approximate joint measurements are still possible. And therefore, approximate joint measurements of position and momentum could at least result in approximate. Now, I have mentioned in words that de Broglie-Bohm had a theory in which the probability density was such that the integral of the probability density over momentum reproduces exactly the position probability density of quantum mechanics. Explicitly, their formula is like this. You integrate over momentum and you get psi x t squared. And in fact, even much before us, Takabayashi had pointed out that if you believe in the symmetry of position and momentum, such a theory, the theory of de Broglie-Bohm, is not satisfactory, because the integral of this phase-space density over position does not reproduce the momentum probability density of quantum theory. Just a simple example will suffice. If you take the minimum uncertainty state from the de Broglie-Bohm theory, you would get a momentum probability density, which is delta p minus p naught, because the gradient of the phase here is just p naught. So you get delta p minus p naught. So the uncertainty delta p for de Broglie-Bohm is 0 for this state, whereas the quantum mechanical uncertainty delta p, you know, this is the minimum uncertainty packet, it's easy to see that delta p quantum mechanics is 1 over 2b. So the momentum description was not required by de Broglie-Bohm to agree with quantum mechanics, and in fact it does not agree with quantum mechanics. But they didn't bother. They said, well, we can only measure one thing simultaneously between x and p, and we will choose x. So that's what de Broglie-Bohm did. However, hopes arise, because in another direction, in 1932, Wigner had proposed a joint distribution of position and momentum, which had the property, as many of you will be familiar with this formula, which had the property that the integral of the Wigner function over momentum reproduced the position probability density, and equally it reproduced after integrating over x the momentum probability density of quantum mechanics. So that's the kind of thing we would like. However, the Wigner function is not positive definite, and so it does not have the physical interpretation of a probability density. So the point is, if we want to take such a theory, if we want to look for such a theory seriously, we would like a positive definite probability density, which had the same properties of reproducing as marginals both the position and momentum probability densities of quantum mechanics. So the idea here is that we have a state with the wave function as well as the instantaneous position and momentum specified, and the corresponding phase space density has the property that it reproduces the separate position and momentum probability densities of quantum mechanics exactly. Can we find such a thing? And as I already mentioned, the Wigner function does not do the job that we want, that we seek. Now, in 1995, we succeeded together with Virendra Singh. We found an example. I say an example because it's the solution we found is not unique. We also found a whole set of solutions. We found the general set of solutions, but I will emphasize here the particular solution, which is very simple, which is that we have some trajectories here in phase space, which are guided by, I will not call it a classical Hamiltonian, it's a causal Hamiltonian, which depends on the wave function also. So it's similar in idea to de Broglie boom, except that it has to do more. Let me emphasize only the three of the points which I have already mentioned, namely rho should be non-negative and it should reproduce the correct marginals, it should reproduce correctly as marginals the quantum position and momentum probability densities. We looked for an answer which was a delta function in momentum, guided both by the de Broglie boom theory but also by the fact that our very familiar free particle wave function has this property, which many of you will know, that if you look at the free particle wave function, evaluate it at x equals pt over m, this is non-relativistic particle of mass m, probability density, this probability density multiplied by t over m time, for time going to infinity, becomes just the momentum probability density. This is in fact the way to measure momentum in ordinary quantum mechanics. What you do is you go very far away from where the particle was, and the wave function evolves, this formula holds, and basically what this formula means is that the phase space density for time going to infinity for a free particle has this form, psi x t square times delta p minus mx over t. In general, of course, this will not be the case for general wave functions. So what we wanted, as I said, we found the complete set of solutions, but I will emphasize just this delta function solution. Look for a solution of phase space density which is modulus square of wave function times delta of p minus p hat, where p hat is a monotonic function of x. And the solution we found was simply choose p hat to be such that the integral from minus infinity to x of psi x square is the same as integral from minus infinity to p of psi p square. It's very easy to see why this formula works. You can see that this delta function, when p hat is monotonic function of x, can be rewritten as a delta function in x. But when you do that, you will get some Jacobian here. And that Jacobian, you will see that from this formula, it gives dp dx equals psi x square over psi p square. So it's just what you need to find that the phase space density is also of the form psi tilde p square times delta function in x. So it reproduces simultaneously both the position and momentum probability densities. So in fact the solution is very simple and very symmetric looking. You see the phase space density can be equally written as psi x square psi tilde p square times delta of minus infinity to x of this minus minus infinity to p of that. And of course this vanishes at p equals p hat xt. So it can be written also as psi x square delta p minus p hat xt. I'll give an example where the function p hat can be evaluated exactly analytically. And that's an example, that's not the only example, but it's an example which you can easily check. If you take the Gaussian free particle for which the momentum space and the position space wave functions are very well known, you find that the answer p hat is given by this formula where beta is the center of the momentum packet and beta t over m is the center of the position packet and delta p delta q are the uncertainties. Delta p of course remains constant because this is a free particle packet and delta q increases with time, expanding wave packet. So now the question is the following. I have here a theory in which I reproduce both the position and momentum probabilities of quantum theory. But I have here a correlation. So each new theory should have new predictions and this theory has a new prediction which is a correlation between the position and momentum. Given position, I know what the momentum should be. And can we test that? Can we, is it in principle at least possible to test this correlation experimentally? So before answering this question, let me briefly mention that the original Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen state for two particles was, I think the, anyway you can hear me, that's enough. Original Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen state was not normalizable. It was a joint eigenfunction of q1 minus q2 and p1 plus p2 and these exact eigenfunctions are not normalizable. But it's, and it, this is the reason why Bohm and Aharonov produced a normalizable version of the PR state with which the questions of the foundations of quantum mechanics, tests of Einstein locality were easy to perform. But now in order not to change the subject too much, let us say that the EPR like state can easily be constructed which are normalizable. That is, instead of being very sharp, instead of being exact eigenstates of q1 minus q2 and p1 plus p2, they could be approximate, they could be very peaked around this value and the wave functions could be very peaked around this value and around that value. And that is the wave function I have written here explicitly where psi1, psi2 are here Gaussians basically. Explicit formula are written, they are easy to check. Now one of the reasons I write this formula is to say that as we had shown for the Gaussian free particle, an exact causal quantum mechanical phase space density, we can do the same for the EPR like wave function. Even though the EPR, so even for entangled states it's possible to do exactly that. Of course this is a somewhat special case because the wave function factorizes. As I said, it factorizes and wave function is a product of function of q1 minus q2 and q1 plus q2 and the phase space density we can construct is correspondingly rho 1 of that times rho 2 of that, where rho 1 is the phase, is the causal quantum mechanical phase space density corresponding to this variable, and rho 2 corresponding to the other variable. So it is possible to mimic the construction that I wrote for the single Gaussian particle. It is easy to extend that to the case of an EPR entangled wave function. And equally, you have a correlation between position and momentum which is exactly calculable. And the next question, it is exactly calculable, but we have within quantum mechanics, we work within quantum mechanics, and is it possible that we could, without violating the rules of quantum mechanics, design experiments which would check this correlation? That is, we have something like an extension of quantum theory. Is it possible to check whether this extension, for instance, agrees with experiments or not? And intuitively, the idea that we thought of to test this experimentally, after many discussions with our friend C.V.K. Bhabha, who was then at TIFR and is now no more, was the following. Here I have a particle emanating from a slit and going towards some detector. This detector, if it is a quantum detector, has a position and momentum which is subject to the uncertainty principle. So if we are going to measure simultaneously a click of this detector, this click cannot have simultaneously precise x and p values. However, this could still be a very good measurement of position and momentum, because it could be that the wave packet that presents itself at this detector has a delta x delta p which is very large, because as we saw before, delta x increases with time, delta p remains constant for a free particle, and the product can very soon become enormous. So I have here a quantum state which has an enormous value of, for this uncertainty product, delta x delta p. And therefore, even if I have a detector which is, which has an uncertainty product of the order of h bar, I could have an extremely good measurement, joint measurement of x and p. And will such a measurement agree with what I wrote down from the causal quantum theory? Now here is the contact I make with quantum information, quantum optics and quantum information. So far, I talked about position and momentum, and here when I try to talk about experimental tests, I face the situation that so far, although this is an in principle idea which looks good, so far it has not been possible to implement this idea. However, quantum optical analogs are very easily feasible. Quantum optical joint measurements of Q and P are feasible, and I will try to discuss a little bit how these things work. And then I have to compare with the theory of joint measurements, the theory of joint measurements in quantum mechanics. So here, in a nutshell again, so that you take back something. For ordinary particles, if I measure, I have an experimental delta p which is much smaller than the width of the wave packet I am looking at. I have an experimental resolution delta x which could be of the order of h bar over delta p. Nevertheless, it could be much smaller than delta x. And for that to be consistent, I have to have delta p delta x product much bigger than 1. And this is possible due to the expanding wave packets for delta xt. Now, I have to think about something when I think of quantum optical tests, so that I get some analog of this increased very large uncertainty products delta x delta p. And I would like to get a situation which I can control, which I can, for which I have exact results. Of course, this is not an experimental necessity, but for a theorist, it's nice to have formulae that you can write down. And so we looked at generalized coherent states which have uncertainty product delta q delta p, which is n plus half, and their EPR like entangled cousins. The usual coherent states in quantum optics have delta q delta p equals half h bar. But it is known for some time that it is possible to write coherent states which in this coherent in the sense that they are shape preserving wave packets, which nevertheless have uncertainty products very large, n plus half h bar. And in this case, I could have, for instance, for the experimental resolutions delta p, delta q, values which are much less than delta p, the width of the state I am looking at, because that width is for these coherent states of order square root n plus half, and delta q, the experimental resolution, which is, let us say, which has to be bigger than 1 over delta p, it can still be much less than delta q, which is square root of n plus half again. So because n is large, even if delta p, delta q are of the order 1, it is possible to have these conditions fulfilled. So this is the reason why I talk about coherent states of large uncertainty. This is a very brief, I have time problem. So I will just qualitatively say that the usual coherent states are eigenstates of the annihilation operator. Their wave functions are given explicitly this, and the uncertainty product is half. They are basically displaced ground state wave functions. The generalized coherent states, which we wrote down in 1982, they are not eigenstates of A, they are eigenstates of A dagger minus alpha star times A minus alpha with eigenvalue n, and they are displaced states of the nth eigenfunctions of the oscillator, where phi and q here are just parabolic cylinder functions. They are well known from the oscillator discussions. And now you see that psi and alpha tau are shape preserving wave packets with classical motion, but with uncertainty product, which is delta q delta p equals n plus half. So there is non-classicality for of these states are certainly non-classical when n is bigger than 0. Because what happens is, well, one of the ways to check non-classicality is through the Wigner function or through quantum tomography. The Wigner function of these states can be explicitly worked out. We know the parabolic cylinder functions. So we compute the Wigner functions corresponding to that by plugging into Wigner's formula. And for instance, exactly for n equals 0, 1, 2, 3, I give the explicit formulas here. These are, this for n equals 0, it is this, which you see has no zeros. This Wigner function in that sense is classic, can be called classical. But the next one, n equals 1, is this Gaussian factor times q minus q classical square plus p minus p classical square minus half. That is, it has a circle of zeros in phase space. For n equals 2, it has two circles of zeros given by the zeros of this. For n equals 3, I have this explicit formula, and I calculated the from the zeros of this cubic that there are zeros when z modulus square is 0.2, 1.14, 3.1. So these are n concentric, well, I have not quite proved it. At least for up n up to 3, I have proved there are n concentric circles of real zeros of the Wigner function. So there is in phase space a non-classicality because of these zeros, non-positivity. And now, again, you don't have to read all these things. There are entangled generalized coherent states for two mode light, which I can now write down. I choose variables q1 plus q2, p1 plus p2 as one conjugate pair, and q1 minus q2, p1 minus p2 as the other conjugate pair. And you see that for this Hamiltonian, I have an explicit solution, which consists of a product of the generalized coherent states functions of q1 plus q2 and q1 minus q2. So it's a product form, and because it's a product form, certain things become very easy to prove. First of all, this thing I can restate again, that the uncertainty products for both the conjugate pairs are just m plus half and n plus half respectively. And these values m and n can be chosen suitably large. The Wigner functions are explicitly given by that formula. And these Wigner functions have zeros on three-dimensional surfaces in phase space, corresponding to one of the factors vanishing. And of course, there are other ways of testing non-classicality. For instance, by means of phase space Bell inequalities. And this work has not yet been attempted, but maybe somebody else. Now, in quantum mechanics, and in particular in quantum optics, it's possible to do joint measurements of Q and P, approximate joint measurements. They are basically extensions of the original idea of von Neumann of how to measure things for single variable, first of all, for Q, and then again extensions of that due to Arthurs and Kelly and others, which showed that joint measurements of conjugate variables are possible with precisions whose product is H bar. That is twice the usual uncertainty product. So these are very straightforward calculations for the joint probability that you get in the experiment to measure the joint probability of position and momentum. You have an answer which has the properties that the uncertainties for x1 and x2, the basic physical idea in making these joint measurements is the following. These formulae are very easy to derive. The basic physical idea is, how do you measure Q and P simultaneously? You have an apparatus in which I have two commuting coordinates, commuting pointer coordinates, one of which measures Q and the other of which measures P. So these x1 and x2 correspond to the values of the commuting pointer coordinates. Even though you are measuring non-commuting observables, to measure them simultaneously, you propose that I have pointers which can be read simultaneously. One gives me the position, the other gives me the momentum. And the result of the theory that gives uncertainties for the pointer coordinates x1, x2, which are bigger, somewhat bigger than the uncertainties for the system due to the resolution parameter for the apparatus. And I will not have time to discuss this in detail. The main point, the main qualitative point I want to mention is that in such a joint measurement, you get a probability density for the joint probability for x1 and x2, which is not a delta function. So in making these tests, you can say, so this is different from the causal probability density. Of course, I mentioned to you the causal probability density is also not unique. But nevertheless, let's stick to the one which I stated already, the delta function probability density. Is it at least true that the maximum of the experimental probability density in such a joint measurement coincides with the peak of the delta function? So that we gave in the formula that I exhibited before. And the result is that the peak of the joint probability density of the Arthur Scaly distribution has a formula which is like that. And answer, yes, in the limit of the resolution, experimental resolution being much smaller than the width of the position packet for the system. And if simultaneously it's true that the error in measuring momentum is also much smaller than the width of the momentum packet, then the formula, the peak you get, agrees exactly with the formula I gave for the causal quantum mechanics with the delta function distribution. Let me give a more easy to read answer. So we say that this works only if the uncertainty products for the wave packets that you are looking at are large to be able to get a reasonable measurement. And in fact, it happens that you see that already if the uncertainty product is 50, well, here it's 50 and 20 are indistinguishable, and even for the product 10, it is very close. So what happens is that the agreement with the causal formula is extremely good, even for much less restrictive resolutions than that what we proposed. So the agreement is good, but of course, this is just a short slide for preferences. I just want to leave you with this formula, which says that don't worry about the exact formulae that we took to test the joint measurements, to exact quantum state. Suppose I have a general quantum state. You look at the Arthur Scaly distributions, we can show that the position probability density, which corresponds to integrating over x2, is given by this formula, which you see is like the quantum mechanical position probability density, except it's multiplied by this factor, which makes it different from the position probability density. However, in the limit of the resolution V being much smaller than the width of the packet delta Q, you see, using this formula, that this a Gaussian over lambda, etc., in the limit lambda going to 0 approaches a delta function. So you see that the integral of the experimental probability density according to the Arthur Scaly joint measurement formula agrees with the position probability density of quantum theory. Equally, the integral over x1 agrees with the quantum mechanical momentum probability density in the limits when the resolutions obey the formula B over delta Q going to 0 as well as B delta P going to infinity. And as I said, these can be consistent mutually only when the product delta Q delta P is very large. So in that limit, it's possible to get a very good test of the causal quantum mechanical theory against experiments. And the experiments can be done using quantum optics with the correspondence of QP with the combinations of annihilation and creation operators. So I think I will stop here.